Very good morning, friends. In this video, we will just learn about a new concept in electromagnetic fields subject. Actually, seeing it is not a new concept for you, I hope you have learned about this in your circuit analysis. So, the name of that particular topic is inductance. So, I hope you have studied something about the inductance and the properties of inductance, how the inductance will behave for DC circuits or for AC circuits. I hope you have studied about these concepts in your circuit analysis. Let me introduce what is meant by the inductance, how can we determine the inductance, all this. So, for this, first of all, I want to define the inductance first. So the inductance, I want to define the inductance. So inductance can be defined as the total flux linkage. So the total flux linkage by current. So the inductance can be defined as the ratio of total flux linkage to the current. This is the definition of inductance. So I can write now mathematically the inductance as N into phi by I. So inductance is basically related to the magnetic nature of the circuits. The magnetic nature can be estimated with the help of inductance, whereas the capacitance basically gives us the electrostatic nature of different elements. So this is the electrostatic nature and this is the magnetic nature. So inductance can be mathematically defined as the ratio of flux linkage to current. Flux linkage is nothing but the product of number of turns. What is N? Number of turns. And what is phi? Phi is flux linking the particular element or particular coil, whatever it may be, and I is nothing but the current flowing through the coil. So inductance can be defined as the flux, the ratio of flux linkage to the current. So the inductance unit is in Henry's. Usually the inductance of different objects will be in milli Henry's or in micro Henry's. So the basic unit of inductance is Henry's. We know this already, I think so. In this video, I just want to make sure that we are not finding the nature of the inductance, all these things, how the inductor will behave, all these things we are not doing in this video. But what we were discussing is how to find the basics. So the main aim of this video is to make you to get familiar to the concept how to determine or how to find inductance, how to determine or how to find inductance for different current configurations, for different types of conducting bodies, for different types of conducting objects or conducting bodies or conductors, whatever it may be. So how to determine the inductance for different types of conducting objects, that is our goal in this video. We'll see that process. Okay, so in order to understand this, we need to follow a simple process in order to understand this. So that simple process is, so first I will start from the inductance expression. So inductance can be given by the ratio of flux linkage to the current. Is it right? Now, in order to know the inductance, what you need to know in the first step are we need to know flux. Is it right? We need to know flux. Now, how can I obtain this flux? So, flux can be obtained from flux density. Is it right? Because flux can be taken as the product of B times A. The flux density into area will give us flux. And how can I get flux density? Flux density can be obtained from magnetic field intensity. So H. So if you know H, you can find B, right? What is H? H is magnetic field intensity. What is B? Magnetic flux density, right? What is phi? Magnetic flux. So if you know magnetic field intensity, from that you can find magnetic flux density, from that you will find magnetic flux. Now how can you find magnetic field intensity? There are two ways of finding magnetic field intensity of different current carrying objects. One way is using Bio-Savart's law, which is the basic law of magnetostatics, and another way is by using Ampere's law. Okay, so now tell me, what is the step by step which we need to follow in order to obtain the inductance? So I will write the step by step here. So firstly, find H and B. Means if you find H, you can automatically obtain B, because what is the relation between B and H? B is equal to mu into H. Mu depends upon the medium. So find H and B using, out of these two laws, we can use any law, or we can take the help of the expression which we have derived already by using Bio-Savart's law and Ampere's law, because we have seen in our magnetic or magnetostatics that we have determined the magnetic field intensity due to different objects like a long and straight current carrying conductor, means an infinite current carrying conductor, a coaxial cable, a sheet of current carrying sheet. So for all these current carrying objects, we have determined the magnetic field intensity. We can use the results of those derivation directly. So find H and B using either Ampere's law or Bio-Savart's law. This is the first step. And in the second step, find flux, right? Find magnetic flux by using the relation phi is equal to B into A. And in the third step, find flux linkage. So some of the authors use the symbol for flux linkage as psi, or some use the symbol as lambda. So flux linkage or psi, it is pronounced as psi. So psi is equal to N into phi. N is nothing but number of turns. And finally, find inductance by taking the ratio of flux linkage to the current. In this way, you can find the inductance by following these four simple steps, right? Now we'll go through one by one. First, we will start with the simple solenoid. Okay, so I am now interested to find the inductance of a solenoid. Now how can you find the inductance of a solenoid? So here I am considering a solenoid like this, and through this solenoid I am allowing some current with the help of some windings. So these are the windings that are provided on the solenoid, right? So these are the two ends of the current carrying conductor. So I am allowing the current like this. So if you have the current direction like this, you will have a magnetic flux produced in this direction. Is it right? Now let me take the help of coordinate systems. So I am assuming this direction as positive x direction, and this direction as positive y direction, and this direction comes out to be positive z direction, right? Now I am interested to find the inductance of a solenoid. Now what is the first step? So in the first step, we need to know H. How can you find H? as already by using Ampere's law or by using Biot-Savart's law, we have determined the magnetic field intensity of a solenoid as H bar is equal to, it comes out to be Ni by L. So the direction of the field, we got this as Ax bar. See, when you allow a current of I amperes, this is the current of I amperes flowing through these windings of the solenoid. When you allow the current like this, you will have a magnetic flux produced in this direction, horizontally rightwards, rightward direction. So what is this direction called as? It is positive X direction. So I have taken it as Ax bar, right? And what is the magnitude of this? It is N times I by, what is L? L is nothing but the length of the solenoid. This is the active length of the solenoid through which we are allowing the current. Hence, this is the magnetic field intensity due to the solenoid which is in positive X direction. So, in the first step, we have determined this. Okay, so you can use either Biot-Savart's law. So Biot-Savart's law expression is used here in order to find the magnetic field intensity of a solenoid, right? Now, in the second step, what we need to know? We need to know B bar. What is B bar? Magnetic flux density. So I can take this as B bar is equal to mu times Ni by L Ax bar. Is it right? Because we know that the relation between B bar and H bar as B bar is equal to mu H bar. Right? Now, units are very important. So, the unit for this is ampere turns per meter, and whereas the unit for B is Tesla, another unit will be Weber per meter square. Right? Now, second step is completed. How can we find the third one? Flux. So, see here, the flux is crossing through this area. This is the cross-sectional area. I am assuming this as S. Right? So, the area looks like this. The cross-sectional area, I am just drawing it separately. This is the cross-sectional area through which the flux is leaving, right? The flux direction now is same as the area vector direction. For this surface, the surface vector direction is also in the same way. So this is the direction of S bar, right? Now it is same direction of H bar, means through this area, if you observe, the field as well as the surface vector direction both are same. So that I can write now S bar as, I am assuming this magnitude of surface area as S, or you can take it as A. So S times, what is the direction? It is in the same direction of the field. This is S bar. Now how can I find flux? Flux can be determined in the, this is the third step I am following, right? So flux can be determined by taking the dot product of B bar vector and surface vector. So what is B bar? It is mu Ni by L Ax bar dot. What is S bar? S bar is S times Ax bar again. So you will get Ax bar dot Ax bar as 1, so that you will have it as mu naught Ni S by L. This is the value of phi, right? So what is N now? N is nothing but the number of turns. I is nothing but the current flowing through this winding, which I have shown here. S is nothing but the area of cross section of this surface through which the flux is passing, and L is nothing but the active length of the solenoid. This is the third step. Now we'll move to the fourth step. What is the fourth step? Fourth step is to find the inductance. So what is inductance? It is the ratio of flux linkage to the current, Henry's. Now, how can I get this? L is equal to N into, what is 5? We got mu NIS by L. So you will get mu NIS by L into I, because you have I in the denominator. So you will have I gets cancelled, right? So now L is equal to mu N square, N into N, N square, S is nothing but surface area by L Henry's. This is the inductance of a solenoid. So hope this is a very, very important expression, because for different examinations, not only for academic examinations but also for competitive examinations, this expression is very much helpful. Mu N square S by L is nothing but the inductance of a solenoid of length L, whose area of cross section is S, which is provided with the number of turns N, where mu is nothing but the permeability. Mu can be obtained by taking the product of mu naught into mu r, right? If the mu r is not given, okay, for problems sometimes mu r will not be given. If mu r is not given, then you can consider mu as mu naught, right? So that you will get L as mu naught N square S by L Henry's. Now, so this is about the inductance of solenoid. In this way we can find simply. Next we will go for another concept, the inductance of another object. So that is inductance of a coaxial transmission line. Inductance of a coaxial transmission line. Hope we have determined the magnetic field intensity in different regions of a coaxial cable or coaxial line. Having known the magnetic field intensity of this coaxial transmission line, now we are in a position to find the inductance. We will follow the same procedure, but first we need to understand how the coaxial transmission line looks like. So coaxial transmission line consists of two current carrying conductors like this. This is one current carrying conductor, and this is another current carrying conductor, right? So this is another current carrying conductor. So this is one current carrying conductor, and this is another current carrying conductor. So this conductor is having the radius of A, and the outer conductor is assumed to have the radius of B, right? Now what is important is the field. This is the region. So what is this? This is the region in between inner conductor, is it right? This is the region in between the inner conductor and outer conductor, is it right? Now what we need to know is, we need to know the inductance of this coaxial cable. So in order to know, so just I am writing here, in order to know inductance of coaxial cable, in order to know the inductance of coaxial cable, we need to know, okay, in order to know the inductance of coaxial cable, we need to know the magnetic field. Field means here magnetic field in between inner conductor. We need to know the magnetic field in between inner conductor and outer conductor, then only we can find the inductance of this coaxial cable or inductance of this region. Inductance of the region between inner conductor and outer conductor can be determined only if you know the field in between the inner conductor and outer conductor. So I am just drawing the cross sectional view, means this is the top portion I am drawing like this. So this is the inner conductor and this is the outer conductor. Is it right? So in between the inner conductor and outer conductor we have a field. Now what is the field direction? For example, when you assume the current flowing through the inner conductor as away from the board and the current flowing through the outer conductor as towards the board, because in a coaxial cable with two current carrying conductors, one current carrying conductor will carry the current in one direction, whereas the another current carrying conductor will carry the current in opposite direction. So here I am assuming that the current carried by the inner conductor is away from the board, whereas the current carried by the outer conductor is towards the board, right? Now because of this current, you have a magnetic flux created here. So this is the direction of magnetic flux. Is it right? Based upon this current direction, using a right hand thumb rule, the thumb shows the direction of current here, whereas the curled fingers is showing the field direction. This is the field direction, right? Now according to Ampere's law we have determined. So let me follow the step by step process here. So in the first step what we need to know? H. So what is H in between these two regions? We got this as I by 2 pi rho. What is rho? Rho is nothing but the radius of the point of interest from the center of the inner conductor. This is the inner conductor and this is the outer conductor. From the center portion of the inner conductor, if I want to find the field in between these two conductors at any place, this is that arbitrary radius, imaginary radius. So it is I by 2 pi rho. The direction is, we will get this as A phi bar, because the field direction is phi direction. The field direction is phi direction if the current direction is positive z direction. Okay, so let me draw the coordinate systems here. This is positive z direction, right? Now this is phi direction. And what is this? This is radial direction, arrow bar. So this is phi direction, this is radial direction, this is z direction in cylindrical coordinate system. So first step in finding the inductance is completed. Now we'll go to the next step. In the next step, what we need to do? We need to know B, right? Now B bar is equal to mu naught into H bar. So now it comes out to be mu naught into I by 2 pi rho A phi bar Tesla, right? So here also we need to know the unit. So it is ampere per meter. So this is second step. And then the third step, what we need to know? We need to know flux. Flux is nothing but B bar dot, is it right? S bar. B bar dot S bar. Now, or I can write this as, in terms of integral form, I can write this as surface integral of B bar dot ds bar. I can write like this also. Now, if you observe, in between the inner conductor, this is the inner conductor and this is the outer conductor, what is the shape of the surface through which the flux is flowing? See, this is the shape of the surface. This is the shape of the surface through which the flux is flowing. This is ds bar. If you want to understand this, let me take my favorite example. So if you have a banana, so let me cut the banana, and so you will have a shape of banana like this if you cut like this, right? Now if you cut it vertically like this, you will observe a rectangular region like this. So this is that region, right? Now how can I write ds bar for this region? I have just shown in the previous page that this variation is rho variation and this variation is z variation. So now I can write this as dz variation, this one, this variation as dz variation, and what is this variation? This variation as d rho variation. So what is the unit vector perpendicular to this? It is a phi bar, right? Now I need to know ds bar for this region. How can I write ds bar which is in a phi bar direction? The simple technique is, first write a phi bar here, then a phi bar is completed, the remaining are rho and z. Tell me what is the variation in rho. The variation in rho can be taken as d rho bar, and the variation in z can be taken as dz. So d rho dz a phi bar, this is ds bar. Now find total flux, right? Total flux can be determined by using this expression, so now it is a surface integral mu naught I by 2 pi rho, is it right, a phi bar dot d rho dz a phi bar. Now as this integration is in terms of rho and z, I can take rho limits as from a to b, because I am considering only the region in between the inner conductor and outer conductor. This is that region, this is that region. And what is the what are the limits for z? Z limits, if I want to know the flux per unit length, or if I want to know the flux for a length of L, because it is not possible to find the inductance for the entire length for the transmission lines. So for the transmission lines we can find the inductance, per unit length only. We can find the inductance per unit length, means for 1 meter length or for a finite length. So here I am assuming this as z is equal to 0 to 1, right? As I want to find the flux as well as the inductance per unit length. Now find phi. For this integration, what are constants? Mu naught I by 2 pi, all are constants. It is 1 by rho. 1 by rho integration is ln of rho within the limits of a to b. Integration of dz is z within the limits of 0 to 1. So you will get into 1. What is the unit? Weber. A phi bar dot a phi bar is 1. Right? Now you will get phi as mu naught I by 2 pi ln of b minus ln of a. You will get ln of b by a. So it is mu naught I by 2 pi ln of b by a. So actually it is the flux per unit length. For 1 meter length I have determined. So it is Weber per meter. Okay, so this is also Weber per meter. Now What is the fourth step? Fourth step is to find inductance. So it is the ratio of number of turns to current. If you consider a coaxial cable, so the current is flowing like this and one current is coming like this. So the number of turns is here only one turn. So here I can take number of turns is equal to 1, so that L is equal to mu naught I by 2 pi ln of B by A by I. Is it right? What is the unit? It is Henry per meter. We can find only the inductance per meter. If you want the inductance for a particular length, just multiply this with that particular length. Okay, so you will get I cancel. Now L can be taken as mu naught by 2 pi ln of right. So mu naught by 2 pi ln of B by A Henry per meter. This is the inductance per meter of a coaxial transmission line. Inductance per meter of a coaxial transmission line. If you want the inductance for particular length, okay. Now inductance for inductance for length L, or let me take different length, because we have used L for inductance already. For length D, how can I find? It is given by mu naught is equal to L into mu naught into D. Just I am multiplying the inductance per unit length with D. So mu naught D by 2 pi ln of B by A Henry's. So this is the inductance per, sorry, not the inductance, it is the inductance for a coaxial cable of length D, which is having the radius, inner radius as A and outer radius as B. In this way we can find the inductance of coaxial cable. Okay, next we will see one more thing, that is the inductance of a toroid. Okay, so toroid looks like a solenoid which is bent in the form of a circle. Okay, so I can call toroid also as a solenoid bent in the form of a circle is called as toroid. So let me draw that toroid here. So it looks like this. It has some thickness. It looks like a iron ring. Okay, so let me erase this and draw a little bit better. So this is the inductance of a toroid. So now we will provide some windings on the toroid like this. This is the incoming side and this is the outgoing side. So when you have a flux like this through the toroid, a toroid is nothing but it is looking like a iron rod or iron rod which is bent in the form of a ring on which we provide some windings. This is the toroid. So based upon this direction of current, you will have the magnetic flux inside a toroid like this, right? So this is the direction of magnetic flux. It depends upon the direction of current which we are supplying. Okay, so the direction of magnetic flux, so let me write here the direction of magnetic flux. It may be clockwise or anti-clockwise. Clockwise or anti-clockwise. Okay, so the direction of magnetic flux, it may be either clockwise or anti-clockwise, depends upon the direction of current through the winding. Direction of current through the winding. And this is the first point which we need to remember. And the second point is the field outside the toroid, the field outside the toroid is zero. Okay, so there will be no field outside the toroid is equal to zero. You have the field only on the surface of the toroid, inside the toroid as well as outside the toroid. Means in this region field is equal to zero, as well as in this region the field is equal to zero. You cannot find any field here. So field outside the toroid or inside the toroid is equal to zero. Now you have only the field in this place. Based upon the direction of current, you will have the field. Let me consider that this toroid has a mean radius of rho naught. Okay, so I am taking the next page. So this is the toroid. So this is the toroid. I am assuming that the mean radius of the toroid as rho zero, and this is the area through which the flux is passing. Okay, so this is the area through which the flux is passing like this, right? So I am considering this area in order to find the inductance as well as all these things. Now how can I get the magnetic field here? Magnetic field depends upon up to which radius we want to find the magnetic field from the center, right? So I am assuming that the rho as an imaginary radius from the center. Now how can I get the magnetic field? So magnetic field B bar can be taken as, directly I am going for the second step. So it is mu naught into H. Mu naught into H, or it is also equal to mu naught into H. What is the magnetic field intensity in this region? So in this region you will have the magnetic field intensity as Ni by, right? Magnetic field intensity as Ni by 2 pi rho. This is H bar, right? This H bar is obtained from Ampere's law. Because when I consider an Amperean path like this, is it right? Let us assume the radius of this Amperean path as rho, and you have the current carrying conductors like this. These are the turns of toroid, like this we have provided, and in each turn we have a current of I. Like that we have n number of turns. I am assuming that there are n number of turns with which the toroid is made with. So there are n number of turns. N is equal to let me put it in this way. So toroid has, assuming that the toroid has N turns, and each turn is carrying current I. So I enclosed is equal to, because in order to write Ampere's law, we need to know the enclosed current, right? So the enclosed current in this Amperean path of radius rho is N times I. Now what is Ampere's law? It is closed line integral of h bar dot dl bar is equal to ni. I enclosed is equal to ni. Now let me put here. Now the h is in phi direction, is it right or not? So I can write h bar as h phi a phi bar, and what is dl bar in phi direction? It is rho d phi a phi bar. It is the line integral, and it is equal to n times I. Now it is h phi into, is it right, rho d phi, integration of rho is constant for this integration, and integration of d phi is 2 pi, and it is equal to ni. From this I can write h phi as ni times 2 pi rho. So the magnitude of the field, is it right, the magnitude of the field here on the surface of the toroid as ni by 2 pi rho. So here I just replaced h bar with ni by 2 pi rho. So second step is completed, and in the third step what we need to know, we need to know flux phi as b bar dot s bar, is it right? So this is the surface through which the flux is moving, and the flux direction is also surface direction is also same as flux direction at that particular point. So you will have mu naught ni by 2 pi rho into s. This is flux which is in Weber's. Next we go for fourth step. In the fourth step we need to find inductance. So it is equal to n phi by I, is it right? So phi is mu naught ni by 2 pi rho into s. So n by I am writing separately. I am writing this as mu naught ni by 2 pi rho into s. Here I am assuming that rho naught is nothing but the mean radius of the toroid, and mean radius, I am assuming that mean radius is very much greater than the dimensions or the surface of the solenoid, so cross-sectional surface of the solenoid. Hence I just replace rho with the rho naught. So you will get mu naught into n square I by 2 pi I into rho naught into s. So I gets cancelled. So you will have L as mu naught n square by 2 pi rho naught into s Henry's. In this way you can find the inductance of a toroidal wire. Here the S depends upon the cross-sectional area through which the flux is flowing. For example, if the cross-sectional area looks like this, so this is the cross-sectional area, it is a square cross-section. You can have the cross-sectional view like this. Okay, So this is a circular cross section. Based upon the cross sectional view, we need to take the area, because if it is a square, you need to take the area as S square or a side square. Side square is the area of this square cross section. Whereas if it is a circular cross section, you need to know the area or the thickness of this. If you know the thickness of this, it indicates you know the diameter of this. Diameter, if you know, by taking half you will get radius, and by taking pi r square you will get area. Here by taking side square you will get area, by taking pi r square you will get area, multiplying that with mu naught n square by 2 pi rho naught, where rho naught is nothing but the mean radius and n is nothing but the number of turns on the toroid. Okay, so let me have a summary of what we have covered up to now here. So first we have seen the mathematical definition of inductance. Okay, next we have seen the procedure in order to obtain the inductance. What are the different steps that we need to follow, simple steps we need to follow in order to obtain the inductance. And in the third step, we have determined the inductance for solenoid. In the fourth part, we have seen the inductance for coaxial line or coaxial cable. In the fifth stage, we have seen the inductance, how to find the inductance for toroid. Okay, these are very, very important for the competitive examinations. If you understand this, you can, if you understand the coaxial cable, you can also find the inductance of a single phase or a current carrying conductor, right? Inductance of a power line, inductance of a power line, we can find this. Okay, we have not covered this in this video. If you understand this, you can find this automatically. Okay, thank you very much for listening to this video. If you have any doubts, please post them in the comment section. Thanks.